Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats.
You know, the dirty little secret about secrets and corruption is that they tend to linger and they don't go away. And if you're within the sound of my voice, that must mean you're in the seats with once more. As always, my name is Dave Voigt, and I'm the host of this podcast, where we sit down with a wide-ranging variety of industry professionals and pick their brain about current projects, state of the industry, how they got started, and so very much more in a light and conversational fashion, because that's how we do it. And if you like how we do it, I'm assuming you do, you're listening right now, we'd love it if you'd subscribe to the podcast. You can find us basically wherever you find your podcast: Apple, Spotify, Google, Amazon. It's all good, and plus every single one of our episodes is archived over at our YouTube channel. Also, we would really appreciate it if you'd follow us on social media. You can do that at Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at either at In Seats or at It's Podcast One for all sorts of updates. And finally, and I dare say most importantly, please pay us a visit over at intheseats.ca, where it all began, where we give you the latest and greatest in the from the movie world, from the TV world, reviews, interviews, lists, anything we can think of, because we love talking about the moving image, and quite frankly, we love it when you read about the moving image, so please check us out. But we got a good one on this episode. It's an interesting one, because it's a movie about a story that maybe many of us had forgotten about, but was still very real and it's still very salient. And the film is called City of Lies, and it's about the story of the murders of the Notorious B.I.G. and Tupac Shakur, and the conspiracy that was in around that, and starring Johnny Depp and Forest Whitaker. And it is on VOD platforms as we speak, it's from director Brad Furman, and it's a good film. It's a darn good film, because it doesn't sort of bombard us with facts. It really does sort of humanize all the characters, and it reminds us sort of the inherent corruption that is built into so many different systems of law enforcement. And it's important to shine a light on those whenever possible. And it's a very well done film. It's really compelling, because it's basically Depp and Whitaker dueling back and forth, and it's a real, if you love actors sort of really chewing into material, this is the kind of film for you. And we sat with director Brad Furman just to talk about sort of the legacy of this story and what got him started on it, and so very much more. And it's a fun talk, which I hope you enjoy, because we get to dive a little bit into to his past, which he thoroughly enjoyed, quite frankly, and so did we. So I hope you enjoy that, and I hope you enjoy this episode, and that's it. Well, I mean, first off, I mean, obviously, thanks for the time today, Brad. I really appreciate this.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it as well.
Now, I mean, obviously, congrats on the film, and I mean, I really enjoyed it. It's one of these things that it feels like it's the worst kept secret that we just don't know enough about, almost. And I'm kind of curious, walk me through, I guess, sort of, I guess, when the book came across your desk and you went, okay, this is going to be a movie.
Well, I think you said it. That was the reason I made the movie. I felt that it was extremely important to get this story and the messaging out into the world. And I felt if we can marry that to these huge heavyweights of, you know, like a Depp and a Whitaker, they would be the perfect vessel and Trojan horse to, you know, bring these stories, and because there's many of them, and message into the world. The book came across my desk pretty much right after it was published through my dear friend Don Sikorsky, who's an EP on the film. But it was a hugely hot property. It was optioned from major studios to Sylvester Stallone to DiCaprio's Appian Way. I was never able to get my hands on it for financial reasons and just stature reasons. And then eventually we never really quit on it. And it fortuitously came to me through the former producer of The Infiltrator, Miriam Siegel. So, you know, we the stick-to-itiveness was paid off in the sense of that I believed it was, you know, movie worthy.
Hollywood is built on never giving up. I love that.
Yeah, there's a bit of a, if you're not resilient and, you know, if you're not able to be that, I don't think you can hang. This is a tough town. So,
yeah, And I mean, I love Johnny's and Forrest's performances, and they really are the anchor for the film. But I mean, I'm so curious because for both these characters, they have to have such a sort of weird fatigue of sort of this case and this environment. And I'm kind of curious how much sort of preparation or research did you have them do coming in to sort of really understand sort of the depth and the gravity of how long these things have been going on?
Well, what's crazy now, it's about 24 years since Christopher was murdered. We shot this movie because it was shelved for many reasons, due to, I think, the police department not wanting to come out, the larger institutional things that were in the way, the bankruptcies, all of these things were holding the movie back from coming out. But they both have different approaches to acting. Forrest, on one hand, wants as much information as he can get his hands on in his preparation. Johnny does, but he soaks it in a way that's very different. So their processes are different. So I try to just work with the ebb and flow of each of them as individuals to give them information. Forrest was more written. Johnny's was more in conversation and the way we would chat and communicate, and he would soak it in. There's a tremendous amount of detail and moving pieces in this story. So there was really a team of us on set constantly just trying to keep all the balls in the air, from myself to Sergio Robledo, who was the lead detective on the Wallace civil case. And he was also Russ Poole's supervisor and has sadly passed since the movie being completed. Jess First, my partner and producer, Christian Contreras, the writer. We were all in concert trying to keep these balls in the air, and it was tricky, but I'm proud to say that the things in the movie are accurate and truthful.
Now that kind of leads into something else I want to ask, because I mean, this is such a hard story. And I mean, like you say, LA is a tough town. Like when you finally had it and you were making it, was there any sort of quiet pushback? Was there any sort of, yeah, don't make this sort of energy that you were getting as you were starting to ramp up production?
When I had decided privately and personally I was going to make the film, there were some people very close to me, all from different walks of life, who had reached out and said, heard through the rumor mill that you're going to make the film, wasn't released yet. I think this is a big mistake. And they gave me a lot of warnings. And that sort of threw me because I didn't fully expect it. I guess I should have. Then when it was publicly announced, my phone rang from different parties. One, a friend from the LAPD, saying you shouldn't make the movie, this is much bigger than you realize, and the corruption is much deeper than you realize, and I would be concerned for your life in certain areas. And so then I got, later in the process, got a few death threats. So it was an interesting journey. I looked into, you know, this notion of private security. I looked into a lot of different things, but at the end of the day, no different than like a hard-hitting journalist, which is how I tried to approach this. I also talked to Randall at great length, like, you wrote the book, you live, you survive. Like, what are your thoughts on this? And sure, there's a fear factor, but that drove me even more to feel that this was so important. And I was really honored to stand side by side with the Wallace family and Miss Wallace in particular, and the Poole family, to tell this really important story. And I made it about that, less about myself.
What is it about LA as a backdrop in general that not just attracts you as a storyteller, but sort of has these stories for us to pull out of? Because I mean, from this story, from Rampart, from even going back years, there have been various tales of corruption from all sorts of walks of power in that area of the world. And I'm kind of curious, what is it about sort of that part of the country that sort of, do you think, breeds this corruption or this almost Wild West mentality, really?
It's an excellent question. I don't have an answer to, but I would say I wish that it was just Los Angeles, because then a lot of our national problems would be much less. This movie was made before all of the, you know, the recent sort of, you know, fights for social justice and Black Lives Matter. And, you know, I was actually shocked during COVID when I went back and looked at the movie, how sort of apropos all these themes and messaging were, and how we were, you know, I guess in theory ahead of the curve on some really important issues. But, you know, I really do wish that they were just Los Angeles, because then we could just close off LA and solve our national problems. But no, I it's so much bigger. And the failure of these institutions across the board that we rely on is challenging, to say the least.
What is it? Okay, but then I guess that dovetails in the second part of the question. For you as a storyteller, what is it about LA? Because, I mean, I've been a fan of yours ever since your first film, and that's also an LA story.
Yeah, thank you. I assume you may be referencing Lincoln Lawyer, but my first film actually, it was also an LA story.
No, The Take. I'm referencing The Take.
Oh, wow. I don't get that very often. So now I'm your biggest fan in the planet. I have such a love affair with The Take because...
I'm in Toronto, so I was there. So
oh wow, so that's super cool, David. I you really made my day right now. That was a big moment for me, not just as a filmmaker, just in wanting to show the other side of LA. I always felt that was really interesting, having grown up a cinephile and movie lover. You know, we saw LA through a particular point of view, right? The palm trees, the Hollywood sign, Rodeo Drive. Like, this is sort of the iconography of LA we were shown. When I moved to Los Angeles to pursue filmmaking, I saw there was another side of LA, and it was a lot of amazing people and many blue collar people and all different types of people from all different walks of life. And I felt that they weren't reflected or shown on film or in cinema in any way. And it was such a unique, beautiful part of LA. And in some ways, I just felt this responsibility to open that door and walk through it. So The Take was the beginning of that. And thank you for, I it's so amazing for me. I never meet any, it's like, it's almost as if The Take doesn't exist. Honestly, God, and I think it may be my favorite film that I've ever been a part of for a multitude of personal reasons. But yeah, literally, it's like everybody thinks Lincoln Lawyer is my first movie. So it's thank you. So yeah, three really big, intricate LA-based movies, and all three exploring the other side of LA.
You know, and I mean, it's important to see these other sides, and I mean, especially when watching this film, I almost got a sense of this was like, in many ways, to me, this felt like a West Coast Prince of the City. In a little bit of a way, and I'm kind of curious for you, especially growing up, like, can you think back, was there a moment in your life or sort of a movie that you think is maybe sort of the formative pivot point that sort of got you into the business?
My first love was always music, and I was gonna have no future in music that I was aware of. My first love next to that was playing basketball as a kid. It was a great way for me to just escape. But then my other first love was movies, and my life existed somewhere between just sitting, and I would go to the theater on my own. I would just watch movies and I loved going to the video store and talking to whoever the video clerk was and just trying to find any movie I hadn't seen, because I felt like I had seen everything. And I spent a large part of my formative early years just watching movies. Like, that's all I did. But I didn't know that you could like make movies or have a career in movies. Like, I think I literally thought, like, I never even thought about like where movies came from. I think in my mind they were like beamed into some theater. I didn't even think the actors were real. There was no world that I was raised where you go make movies for a living or work in movies. But when I saw how hard my parents worked and the hours they worked, and then I lost my cousin at a very young age, I started looking at my own mortality, and I said, well, what do I want to do with my life and what can I do? And when the idea of pursuing movies just sort of came to me, I guess more around the age of 19, I transferred to film school and I just rigorously pursued it with everything that I had. And I realized also I had gotten these VHS tapes of great filmmakers and their short films. And what really blew my mind was it was a craft that you could learn. It's very daunting to be a fan of these classic great filmmakers and feel like, how can I do what they're doing? But then when you see their short films and you're like, huh, they're not really as good as their other work, you start realizing that you can learn too. And I also innately had some gifts that I was born with that lent to, you know, working as a director and a filmmaker. So I guess in that respect, I leaned into something I had some strengths in. So that was really positive.
Now, I mean, just to start putting a bow on this, I mean, in watching this film, it really feels like a story about two guys ultimately at its core, just trying to do the right thing, but not quite getting nearly as far as they want to in the whole process. And I'm kind of curious, what is it for you about those kind of stories that show, you know, positivity, but reality at the same time, to sort of be able to put those on the screen, to be able to, it's like, we still have to put in the effort, even though we're not always going to get the payoff that, or the Hollywood moment that we may necessarily want in these kind of situations.
Well, I think for Russ Poole, it was heartbreaking, literally. I mean, he died in the sheriff's office, to find out that not even the sheriff's office was willing to further pursue the case, even with the new information and evidence that he had gathered. I think that's equally true with conversations I've had with Bob Mazur and The Infiltrator, because he feels like he did all this work, but when he looks at the larger impact of what he's achieved, he feels like the impact is minimal, if not even something you can account. So I think these things are challenging, and I guess because what I feel, again, it's my theory that people are watching movies in today's world more than they're reading books, and, you know, foundationally learning to read and reading books is the basis of great storytelling. I feel for me, bringing honest human characters to the screen is really significant and important. I was really inspired by Spike Lee's Do the Right Thing.
Yeah.
Because it took me out of movie land, even though it's this movie that's like a play, the idea of what's going on in the neighborhood had this really unique, inspiring balance between truth and fiction.
Yeah.
And I feel he threaded the needle ever so perfectly. And ever since then, that was a key turning point for me, because being raised with, you know, many of my Black friends growing up in Philadelphia, I never saw any movies that reflected my life in that sense. So as a result, Do the Right Thing did. It spoke to me, you know, the scene in the pizza shop with John Turturro, where he's talking about how, like, you know, Mookie's saying to him, like, this guy's Black that you love and that guy's Black. And Turturro's like, well, they're not Black. And he, you know, he sort of catches them, because obviously they are, in referencing Prince and Michael Jordan and Mike Tyson and all these classic, you know, iconic figures, but also Black figures. So as a result of that, these messages really, really spoke to me, because Dr. J, and in particular, and Michael Jordan were very prominent Black figures that really were inspirational in my life. And then later Tupac and Biggie. I just didn't want to make a movie shifting gears that exploited the death of these young men. I wanted to make a movie that spoke to their lives and honored their lives and got us asking larger questions about why are we in the situations as a world that we're in, and you know, have the institutions and us as individuals take real responsibility for the things that have gone wrong.
No, and I think you're absolutely right. And I love that you brought up Do the Right Thing, because I mean, in City of Lies, definitely felt them as people as opposed to characters or as these larger than life figures. And ultimately, at the end of the day, that's the important part, because these are people who are getting killed needlessly for whatever reason, you know, God knows why, and these crimes aren't being solved. And it's an important thing to sort of put a highlight on and just sort of remind the world that this shit still goes on and it's bad. But thank you again for the film, and thanks for the time today. And I'm glad I made your day.
Oh my God. Yeah. That is amazing. I am thoroughly impressed. You've got a special spot in my heart, David. I thank you profusely. And thank you for your kind words on the film and taking the time today.
Cheers, brother. Thanks, guys. And don't forget to visit our friends over at Bay Street Video for all your DVD, Blu-ray rental or purchasing needs this summer, as they are still open for curbside and some mailing delivery as well. Over at 1172 Bay Street, Toronto, Ontario, Canada, you can give them a call at 416-964-9088. That's 416-964-9088. Or send them an email at baystreetvideoto@gmail.com for any of your DVD and Blu-ray needs.